It's the album that appears on every indie rock fan's album tier list, along with OK Computer by Radiohead and In the Aeroplane Over the Sea by Neutral Milk Hotel. Loveless by My Bloody Valentine continues to allure shoegaze fans nearly 30 years after its release in November of 1991. While the hell that was the production of Loveless is widely documented and discussed, let's go back to the earliest days of My Bloody Valentine and examine their journey from an inspired gothic post-punk group to shoegaze icons. Kevin Shields was born in Queens, New York in 1963, but would move to Dublin, Ireland in his childhood years. Inspired by the English punk bands of the 1970s, Shields would form his first band called The Complex when he was 16. The band consisted of Shields on guitar, Liam O'Moanle on vocals and guitar, Colm O'Keeshowig on drums, and a guy named Mark on bass. The band of teenagers would perform covers of the Sex Pistols and Ramones songs before disbanding sometime around 1981 when O'Moanle left to form Hot House Flowers. The remaining three members of the band would regroup to form A Life in the Day, another short-lived band in the early 1980s, and featured more of a post-punk inspired sound from bands like Siouxsie and the Banshees and Joy Division. The band failed to draw much of an audience, so Shields and O'Keeshowig would form My Bloody Valentine in 1983 and would recruit David Conway as the lead vocalist. The band would have a series of lineup changes throughout 1983 and 84 and would release their debut mini album, This Is Your Bloody Valentine, in January of 1985. Inspired by the Australian post-punk band The Birthday Party, the album failed to capture much of an audience and was described by critics as unfocused and derivative. Following its release, the band would relocate to London and the members lost contact with one another. They would regroup later in 1985 and would be signed by the record label Fever Records. In December of 1985, the band would release their debut EP, Geek, with the newly recruited Debbie Goodge on bass. Similar to their debut mini-album, Geek was largely ignored. Despite its lack of commercial success, Geek was a step towards the band's genre-defining sound as it distanced itself from the gothic rock influences in This Is Your Bloody Valentine and incorporated noise pop into the mix. The band's second EP, The New Record by My Bloody Valentine, continued down this noise pop path that could be heard in Geek. Released in September of 1986, The New Record by My Bloody Valentine saw continued experiment with noises and distortion inspired by the guitar feedback which can be heard in the Jesus and Mary Chain's debut album, Psycho Candy. I know that it's unhealthy, I'm fantasizing everything. The EP would also see some commercial success, peaking at number 22 on UK's independent singles chart. Vocalist David Conway, however, would depart from the band in April of 1987, with Belinda Butcher being recruited as the replacement. The band would now have its final lineup with Kevin Shields and Belinda Butcher both on vocals and guitar, along with Debbie Googe and Colm O'Keeshowig continuing to be on bass and drums respectively. Under this new lineup, My Bloody Valentine would release the non-album single Strawberry Wine, followed by their second mini-album Ecstasy in November of 1987. Both of these releases were praised for sounding more focused than their previous releases, despite the fact that Shields would remark the sessions that, I quote, bashed out all these tunes quickly, very demo-like. The band continued to experiment with noise pop along with jangle pop, inspired by 1960s groups like The Birds and Love, further distancing themselves from their earlier post-punk sound. One writer described Ecstasy as, quote, bubblegum pop with buzzsaw guitars. However, Shields was unsatisfied with the album, stating, and I quote, "Even when we'd finished it, we didn't like half the songs we'd done. The record never came out right, and it made us realize that we were still too tween. there was still much more room for growth, and 1988 would prove to be a transformative year in the development of My Bloody Valentine's sound. Shields began to smoke cannabis and changed the way he played the guitar, stating, quote, "I discovered that it was extremely sensitive to velocity and how high you hit the string. You could make huge waves of sound by hitting it softer or harder. This wave of sound Shields strived to create was inspired by the guitar playing of Thurston Moore of Sonic Youth and Jay Maskus of Dinosaur Jr. Shields took this inspiration and pushed the boundaries of sound, incorporating reverse reverb along the way. This can be heard in My Bloody Valentine's third EP, You Made Me Realize, released in August of 88. In many ways, You Made Me Realize was My Bloody Valentine's breakthrough release. It was much noisier than anything else they'd released before, incorporating guitar distortion and feedback into the mix. Their following EP, Feed Me With Your Kiss, released just a few months later, was similarly acclaimed and featured the same noise and distortion as You Made Me Realize. At this point in their career, My Bloody Valentine was ready to release their first full-length studio album, Isn't Anything, in November of 1988. Critics and fans alike found the album to be remarkable upon its release. Described as a pioneering shoegaze record, Isn't Anything incorporated elements of lo-fi avant-rock into its mix, featuring androgynous vocals along with overwhelming guitar feedback. The album is unearthly and slightly eerie at times, and even decades after its release, nothing sounds quite like it. By the end of 1988, My Bloody Valentine had developed a reputation as a revolutionary and boundary-pushing group. My Bloody Valentine would follow up the release of Isn't Anything with their 1990 EP, Glider. The album would be named after a guitar playing technique Shields had developed called glide guitar, where the player would strum while holding the vibrato bar, creating a unique and wavy sound. Their 1991 EP release, Tremolo, was released to similar acclaim, sounding equally as blurred and dreamlike as Glider and Isn't Anything. And finally, My Bloody Valentine would release their landmark second studio album, Loveless, in November of 1991. Upon its release, Shields was praised by critics for his, quote, virtual reinvention of the guitar. The album featured Shields' glide guitar technique along with Butcher's dreamy, sensual vocals. Regarded as shoegaze's defining release, Loveless opened the door to new musical possibilities that created countless My Bloody Valentine-inspired bands, including the Smashing Pumpkins and Radiohead. However, after rumors of nearly bankrupting Creation Records and feeling the pressure to release a follow-up to Loveless, Shields collapsed under the stress and virtually disappeared from the public. While attempts were made throughout the 90s to record a third studio album, My Bloody Valentine would ultimately break up in 1997. With Loveless, Shields left behind a template for underground rock bands throughout the coming decades. Throughout the late 90s and early 2000s, Shields would collaborate with other music groups including Dinosaur Jr. and Primal Scream. He also composed four original tracks for the soundtrack to the 2003 film Lost in Translation. My Bloody Valentine would regroup in 2007 to embark on a world tour. However, it wouldn't be until February of 2013, 22 years following Loveless, when My Bloody Valentine would finally release their third album, MBV. Recorded throughout the mid-1990s, late 2000s, and early 2010s, MBV managed to push the limits even further than Loveless, incorporating elements of jungle and drum and bass music into the critically acclaimed album. With My Bloody Valentine being signed to Domino Records in March of 2021, along with their entire discography being made available to streaming services, there is reason for My Bloody Valentine fans to be excited. The band has even announced that they are working on two new albums, with Shields commenting, quote, "I don't want to be 70-something wanting to make the next record after MBV. I think it'd be cooler to make one now." Whether My Bloody Valentine releases five more studio albums or none at all, the band has secured its legacy as one of the most groundbreaking and astonishing bands in musical history. Hey guys, this is Mitch Kieran, the narrator of the video, wanting to thank my good friend Nathaniel Jordan for once again letting me help narrate. He's put in a lot of hard work to research and convey his perspective on music that he's very passionate about. Nate is a huge music buff and is clearly passionate about shoegaze, amongst many other genres, and he even recommended Loveless to me in college. So make sure if you haven't yet to hit that subscribe button and let us know in the comments if you enjoyed the video. Nate's got plenty of great ideas ahead, and I'm hoping to be included on more of his projects. Alright, thanks for watching.